In insurance, if you make the insurance of one car, it's gambling. It's risky. If you make insurance of 100,000 cars, it's statistics. It's clear the risks are not like one car. And this is big numbers. Statistics work with big numbers, not with one. And, well, when there are other business, let's say we are talking with prepaid telecommunications. When we think about the prepaid, and we talk about the prepaid business, what I like of the business was they have many things, many positive things, no? Actually, I call it the Gillette plan. Because in Gillette, you sell the razor or you promote the razor to sell shapes. Here we were promoting the handsets, subsidizing handsets to sell phone cards. That was the concept. And the concept, we make a design of a packaging to have it in the supermarket and to sell them you go and you, like, you buy a razor, you buy a telephone, and you have all this presentation, special, et cetera, et cetera. And we look that it was very interesting in many ways. First, you will make it very popular because you can have it at the hand in all the supermarkets and every place. Second, you will have expenses, bigger expenses, because there will be more churning, and you need to pay commissions for the cars, and you need to pay commissions for the handsets. But there were a different price. Prepaid has a higher price that for per minute that the postpaid. And it was interesting because when you take in business average cost, average X, you have mistakes. You need to make the analysis of everything. It is not for the public, but I should say that my partners didn't like us, and they went to meet us to say we don't agree with the prepaid program. It is not profitable. It's jeopardized. You are jeopardizing. You are cannibalizing the other market, et cetera, et cetera. And there were a lot of opposition to this concept. Actually, in Canada, in U.S., and in other countries, it's not very usual to have these prepaid programs, like it's in the market that has grown strongly. And when you have a country with very low income, or many countries with low income, is the best way because they have the handset that is subsidized, and they have the calling party pays, and they buy cars when they need the cars and when they have the money to buy the cars. And they don't need to pay a fixed rent every month because the revenues they have are not uniform. And sometimes they have the money and sometimes they don't have it. And developed countries don't necessarily understand this program, no? But I think has been very, very important, very successful. More than 90% of our market is prepaid. In many countries of the world, more than 90% is prepaid. I think Nigeria is one of them. In China, India is very popular. And I think we begin it in 94, 95 with the concept. And we have done very well with this program. We also segmentate the market. And when you segmentate the market, you can segmentate in postpaid, but with postpaid, maybe you don't arrive to all the market. And if you take all the market, you go to prepaid, and you will have all the people that doesn't have a regular income, that sometimes has money and sometimes no, that want to have a control of the cost, and they want to manage in this way, no? We were only two or three Mexican groups and 12 or 14 foreign groups. And we begin to talk with all the foreign groups. We talk with maybe 8 or 10. And we like a lot SBC, and we like France Telecom. And we agreed to go for Telmex with them. Actually, we bought 25% of the company, not 100%, 25. Telmex was already in the stock exchange. The government has the majority, was not 100% owned by the government. It was 50-something. And we pay like eight or 10 times the value it has 3 years before. And we bought Grupo Carso, not me, Grupo Carso that was a public company, we bought 5%, 5.1, something like that. SBC bought 10%, the French bought 5.2, something like that, another group of Mexicans 5.2. And we bought that. The biggest stockholder was Southwestern Bell, that the after called SBC. And in the market, many people win a lot of money because the stock went from nothing to we pay $8.6 billion for the 100%. That's 1.7 for the 20%. And, the mobile service was there. It would have like 25,000 customers, something like that. Now we have 150 million. We grow 66% for 15 years, every year. I believe in circumstances, and I think that you make your own destiny. But your own destiny depends on the circumstances. And that in some way you can say that circumstances take you to some destiny, maybe to some destiny, you know? But I believe in the freedom to create your own future, no? Because if there is not there, it's in other place, but you will find it. And it's very clear by common sense, the growing of mobile, because of many reasons. First, it's cheaper because there are not the paraphernalia that you have in landline. You have a copper going from each home to other home, and big hoppers to the centrals. It's very complicated, a landline company, no? A landline network. It's like a water or power line. You need to have the pipe to the, you cannot send water by wireless or energy, but you can send voice by wireless. And you know about broadband, TV. You know that with a big antenna, you send to every place the signal. Well, if you can develop a network that you don't need wire and cable and copper and all this, that means that it's a lot more efficient and more cheaper than the other. And when you are giving a landline, you are giving a landline to a house, to a home. But a mobile is for a person, and there are more persons than houses, no? You can maybe 3 or 4 persons per house. That means that if you have a 20 million or 25 million houses, you have 100 million persons. And it's cheaper. The operation is a lot cheaper for communication. It was beginning the technology and the operation. And many telephone companies, landline companies, don't want to develop this because jeopardize the landline. And we put them into compete. We separate Telmex from America Mobile to compete between them, because the biggest competitor for local service is mobile. In cellular and telephony, you are going to convergence. That means that the restricted TV that a few ones have that in our countries will be very popular. Everyone will have. You can make contain like for mobile. Now it's happening something interesting because some companies like Google, and maybe, I don't know, and others, one will use the infrastructure of the telecommunication companies and maybe the mobile companies to sell advertising. They give the content, they are taking the model of the broadband in some way. broadband, is the TV is free because they sell advertising. Google give you free the contain because they are going to sell the advertising. I think they will sell also e-commerce and e-finance, no? by taking the customers. And I think in entertainment is a lot of things that was contained, education, in health. People will have a lot of time. It's an economy of services. You need to offer services to many people that is now out of the market. I think a lot of areas, mining, because Malthus has a mistake, and also the Rome Club, you remember the Club of Roma? Rome Club that say in the 60s that there were not big commodities because the population, the demographics. The issue is not the demographics. The issue is the demographics out of autoconsumption. Because if the demographics like China is in autoconsumption, they don't ask for commodities, they are in autoconsumption. But now that China is getting out of autoconsumption, and India and America, and maybe Africa, not very far from now, all the production of commodities will be very important. I think the new civilization offer a lot of things to do massively. And well, you are looking at the iPod, a way to give music, the iPhone or the way for do Google, the way to give a contain or to give information and entertainment. You are now going to give more services. You give voice. Now you give data like we were looking, SMS and phone. Now, let's say the digital cameras will get out of the market because the mobile will be the camera and will be everything, no? And you will give data and you will give some video information and other kind of services by the phone. Also, maybe his finance and a lot. It will be connected to internet. Actually, the computers, there is a doubt because which will be the laptop? I think the laptop will be the mobile. Instead of bringing you big laptop, you have a small one, and you connect it to your when you arrive to your home or to your office to your PC. But what we are proposing, I was proposing to the people of Nokia, and we met with Steve Jobs and Jim from BlackBerry, is for education, to give to all the children with low income, without income, digital alphabetization, a mobile instead of a laptop, and that he connected not to the computer, but to the screen of the TV. Because people don't have a PC, but have a screen in his TV. The other point is that the server can be in the school or given by the company. There are coming many things. In 1 year or 2 years, coming very fast. And it's interesting because everything I am telling you, I don't understand very well. Well, I don't use the computer, but I understand that internet is very important, that you can be connected, that you have a chip and you put the chip and you connect that to your PC. Well, connect to your screen and you will save a lot of... and you will have all the students of 6 years, 8 years, 10 years in our countries with any handset that can have a connection to internet and connected to his screen. Well, I think the future will be great. Maybe in the next year we will have crisis, big crisis, the world, no? But for me, it's very clear that this new civilization develop and sustain in the welfare of the others. As much as the others are better, everyone is better. What I was telling before, fight poverty is now an economic need. It's not only a social issue or social justice or ethical problem. It's an economic need. Thus, in the future, I think that everyone will want to have the others educated, the others with income, because they will be the market, they will be the sustain of the growing of the economy, the welfare of the others. That means that I don't know when, but things will be very good. But I am clear also that there will be problems before arriving to this stage, like it happened now. First of all, I think that telecommunications is like a nervous system of the new civilization. That in this new civilization, like I was telling, is a civilization of services. Technology has gone so far that productivity is very high. And when you have productivity very high, you can create goods and services very, very low cost and very in very important scale. That means that people don't need to work so much time, and the productivity so high is create wealth more easy. And the issue is how to make the conduction of the society and the economy by the government to make that these things work. I think China is doing a great job on that in that direction. I think they have very clear about the long-term vision, and they understand what is the globalization, and they are looking the globalization and making it good for them, the best for them. I think each country has its own conditions. A country with 1 billion people is different than a country with 1 million. A country with so much population has a big domestic economy and will be the main issue to manage, no? India and maybe Brazil and Mexico. But I think each country has his own situation and his own step of development that is different. But what is clear is that everyone will sure learn from China, but from Korea. But most than learn of them, it is to have clear education, go from the alphabetization to digital alphabetization, not to teach A, B, C, D, but digital alphabetization, convergence, connectivity, and modern education, middle and superior education levels, and strong work in education. Very strong in education and science, technology, engineering, all this. Richelieu, at the first part of 17th century, they say that you need to support mechanical arts, mechanical arts, no? Education, mechanical education. I think now is very important to teach about all these issues without taking out humanism and this education and create jobs and create activity, economic activity, investment, reinvestment. I like to know about history of my country, but I also are interested in the universe, astrophysical, the origin of the universe, the origin of men, and the development of men. And if you look the development of the men from the 5 million years or 6 million years to now, the different times, and how it began until only 10,000 years to find the agriculture and the civilization, and how the civilization is so near, so short term, how the civilization has developed, and for me it's very clear, and the new civilization that we are living after the agriculture civilization, the industrial civilization, and in this new civilization, the good thing of this new civilization is that the welfare of people is what gives the success of the society. In the agricultural civilization, the men make the exploitation of the men and the land. That's why they were slaves, and they were not mobility. And like you born, you live all your life in the same place and in the same social way. And the power was monolithic, with political power, economical power, political, military power, and religious power, all together. The emperor came from the divinity. The pharaoh came from the divinity. The monarchy came from the divinity. All were together. The same in Mexico that in China, Japan, Egypt, any place. That was monolithic, the power. With the new civilization and from the industry civilization, it changed completely. The paradigms are very different. And the new paradigms are democracy, liberty, plurality, human rights, environment, globalization, competence. And the good thing is that before you explode the raw materials, the land, and the people. The slavery was not an accident. It was part of the paradigms of the civilization. But the new civilization, poverty is not business like before. You need to have people with income. You need to have people involved in the new economy with time to relax and look entertainment, other areas, no? And well, in the future of the civilization is there. I think the government should have a clear vision of this new civilization, because the best investment is fight poverty. The best investment is to fight poverty. In the past, it was ethical and moral and social justice. But now it's an economic need. The countries like US, that they say is a consumption economy, a consumption population, is not a consumption population, it's a welfare population. That's what should be done all around the world. Maybe a third world war, how you say, against the poverty. And it's clear for me that it will come. The people will be out of poverty, and for that you need education. You need education and education. And what we need in our countries is development, employment, and education. And that's clear. It's not internet, it's this. And as much as you have people with income and with employment, and better income and better employment, you will have better markets, bigger markets. And that's what be very important for the government to look at, because there will be many bottlenecks in the future. Energy is one, but we will have many bottlenecks, because the poor people of the world, like China, India, Latin America, will get involved in the market, and sooner than what we wait. And that means that should be conducted, these changes, this transformation should be conducted. But it's not internet, it's all this, the future. Very important, I think so. I think in two ways. First, you need to, if you are in business, you need to understand the environment. You need to have a vision of future. And for that, you need to know the past. I think it's very important from this side, like a businessman, but also in the personal side, a businessman cannot be only in business. You need to have more interests. Life offers a lot of interest, many things to know, to learn, to feel, to live. How it was? Well, it was, I enjoy it a lot. In the first years, I went to a very small school, like kindergarten, 2 blocks from my home. We were 5 in my class, and the park was just in front. We played in the park, and I enjoy a lot my first years. Well, maybe all my years, but especially when you are talking about me like a child, I enjoyed it a lot. Many friends, a very good family, my father, my mother. I have 5 brothers and sisters. And I study in small schools all my life until I finish half of the secundaria. That's called you high school. Mm-hmm. And then I went to the National University, that is one of the biggest universities in the world, more than 300,000 students there. We have their college, postgraduate studies, and preparatoria, we call preparatoria. Instead of high school, we used to make in this year, in those years, 3 years of secondary after primary, and then preparatory, 2 years of preparatory and 5 years of college. It's interesting. Some years I was very good and some years no. In some subjects I was very good and in others I was very bad. But let's say in secondary I was very good. In primary, and in college, I was very good in some subjects. I was very good in my second year, the third year. In the 4 and 5 year, I was thinking to change of career, but I began to give classes like a professor in the university when I was in third grade. I like to play. I like numbers. My father was a businessman, and he get us to the business, the commerce, and he tried to teach us how to work when we were very young, maybe 8 years, 10 years. And I like some sports, to look some of them, to play with groups, like baseball or football, basketball. And it was, we have also, like I told you, a park in front, and we play with our neighbors. Sometimes in those times there were not cars, and you can play in the street baseball, no? And we used to play it in the park, American football and baseball. I was the youngest of the group, near the youngest. It was difficult when my father died. My father died when I was 13, and I have difficult times, maybe 2 years. It was the adolescence, and it was also the death of my father, and it was very difficult times for me. My mother born in Mexico, and my father arrived at Mexico at 14 years, when he was 14 years, in 1902, a little more than 100 years ago. Well, the Ottoman Empire was very tough with the Christians. And I understand that they put in the army or something like that when they were very young, and that's the reason, the main reason why they emigrate, the Christians, emigration of Lebanese. The first immigration that is until the finish of the First War was because of the empire that has control of Lebanon. I think everyone is immigrant. If you go to the glaciation, people move around every place. They were nomads all around. America, all people is, including the Indians that came to America maybe 25, 30,000 years ago. Everyone is immigrant from one form or the other. And I think immigrants are very strong people. When you left your country without knowing the language of the other countries, without knowing the culture, without knowing where you are going, and you are only 14 years, you should be very strong, and you get stronger with this. I think immigrants in general are very, very hard workers and very strong inside itself. They should be very strong. My father was very strong hero for me, his personality, his kindness, how he was strong, firm when he needed to be firm, how he was amoroso, lovely, love, and my mother, I think my father was very important, like I told you, especially because he died. And so maybe some teacher I admire, some teachers, some sportsmen that make achievements, very strong achievements. And I think it was very important. In sports, you have a lot of people that you admire at this age, where you read in the newspapers, and other people that make achievements, like the ones to swim the channel in Europe, and many sportsmen. I think I always know that I was going to be a businessman, because I begin to invest when I was 10 or 12 years. I begin to make my first investments. I opened my check account, and I was investing already very young. And I think I know that. My father gave us 5 pesos every week. And when you have a birthday or something, and they give money to you, you need to make something with that, with your savings. And you can have it physically, but you can also put them in a bank on an investment, and I went to the investment. I have, let's say, a surplus of income against my expenses. That means that you have savings and you need to make something with them. And then you begin to think what to do with them, and you invest them. In those years, you take the decision very young, when I was 14 years. And I select engineering because I like numbers. I think some people like letters, others like numbers. To some ones, the letters tell something to them. To others, numbers tell you something, no? And I am a man of numbers from when I was very young, and that's why I select engineering. I think it's very important for your career. The engineer studies is very important, was very important for me, because you work with exact science and experimental science. And that's very important. You know that not everything is exactly. You know that science comes from experiments also. And I think my career has been always important. I make a construction company. I am very involved in a mining company. I am in telecommunications. And that's very good. Engineering is a very strong basis for business, I think. Well, first, I think the success is not to make money or to have companies or to be a professional outstanding. The success is your life. The success is your family, your friends. In this way, I think I am very successful. I have been very successful because of my fathers, my sisters, my brothers, and especially because of my family, my children, my wife. I think that's really success, no? And my friends. In the other way, when I professionally, I studied, like I told you, engineering, but I like economy. And when I was in the last years, I was thinking to study some economy. Actually, when I finished, I took courses in economy. 3 months first, and then another 3 months in Chile. I went to study there. And I think that when you have the vocation, it's difficult to find one people with a very, very strong vocation only for one thing. And I have curiosity for many things. I have interest for many things. And when you study engineering, I study some economy, I decided to take, when I was 24, a sabbatic year to look what I was going to do, to think, to travel. After I study and the economy and I make my engineer career. And in 65, I begin to be involved in business. From the beginning, I was involved in many business. I had a bottling company. I bought a bottling company. I make an investment firm, a construction company, real estate company. I begin with 5 or 6 different areas of work. And I believe I understand that there are a confusion between in the business, between the businessman, the entrepreneur, the executives, and the investors. There are 3 different persons. But in a small business, regularly, the same person makes the 3 things. Is the investor, is the businessman, the entrepreneur, and is the executive, the CEO. I was very clear that CEO and businessman is different, and investors is different. And as much as I follow my career, I work with executives. My work, like a businessman, was to work with executives, with CEOs, to make them develop his capabilities. We look potential development of the company. To buy it in a low price or in a bad condition, it make it easier. But the good thing is the potential of the company, how far it can go, how far you can develop the company. I think more than instinct is knowledge. Look the numbers, like I told you, numbers talk. You look the numbers, you look what they are doing, and we have a philosophy of working that make these things not very difficult, because when you work with austerity, sobriety, and you invest in equipment and you reinvest, there are, I think, some basic rules, nothing magic, only basic rules to find out which are the conditions of the company and how to change them. What is clear also for me is that you can do it very fast. You can do it very fast, and the faster you do that, the best is for the business, for the company, for the people involved to make that, no? And well, you need to work in the whole area, not only finance, not to look only one area. You need to look labor, your treatment with people. You need to look that the people should be feel good in the work they are doing, to be motivated to be there, to have the spirit to be in the company. And you look also sales, you look production, you look finance. You need to look the whole company and arrange the areas where things are doing bad. Let's say one example. In some companies, you have a lot of levels of management. That's not working, no? Many levels are not working for the operation. They have headquarters far from the operation, corporations. The corporation is outside the operation. We work without corporate people. We focus in operation. We take down as much levels as we can to make that the highest level be near the operation. And well, with practice and the experience, we have make a team that is very efficient to do that. And we do that very fast. And I think it's not instinct, it's experience that you can learn, because it's not done only by me, it's all the team, and the organization is very big. We have near 200,000 people working in the group. And we have a lot of young men doing this kind of jobs that take basic rules of management to do that, no? And well, in the way you read a lot of books, how they do, what they do bad, what they do good, the conglomerates of the 60s, the way they manage the biographies of some people, what they do, and you can take the good things of them, not everything, no? And the experience, you can, I think, have experience from the failure of the others and your failures, no? And what we do when we are managing business is that we need to take decisions, but we try to do small mistakes. We are very, very open to do small mistakes. Big mistakes is very dangerous, no? Very big mistakes is dangerous, but small mistakes make the people train and learn how to take decisions and move ahead. Well, it was in 82. I was 42 years old. I have a good experience. And there were many factors that make it very clear that I should do that. During the revolution, and that's very important, the experience of my father, my father make his business, buy 50% to his brother, invest in Mexico. My father was very young. He has not family. He was not married. He was without so much roots in the country, and he stayed in Mexico. You cannot make any comparison with a revolution. And he invested in during that time, and he worked hard in this time in the after 1911 to 1920, during all these times. And when you read about what happened in US in the 30s, it was clear that the country is not finished. We have a big problem because the fiscal deficit was very high, but also because the interest rate went up of 20. It was 21 or 22 prime rate. And that's not forever. You need to solve these kind of things. And the prices of the companies was crazy. And there were two factors. Not only the values were very low. That was really, really very low. Let's say 3% of the book value, 5% of the book value. Was crazy. Very, very low. But also that there were available business. Because in our country, the companies has a group of control regularly because there are not so big companies, and there are a group, a person, or through the bank that the control of the companies is there. And in these years, the US companies want, the foreign companies want to sell because to be invested in Mexico was not good, and they sold out his Mexican operation. And the banks sold the assets, and many people want to sell everything. And we were the only buyers. And that's one of the reasons I get so complex group with so many sectors, because they were available one day and the other and the other and the other. That's the only reason we were involved in so many things. And for me, it was very clear that a company that have a debt in foreign currency has also assets in foreign currency. And it was an accounting problem. Let's say a company before the devaluation that buy an asset and has a debt in foreign currency is bankrupt the next day. But if you make the investment the next day of the devaluation, you adjust accounting. You see, there are also accounting problems that make think that the things are worse than what they are, no? I think it was very important, the experience of what my father's done. I know that. The history of Mexico, how we have problems in the past, from the 19th century also, and the experience of the economies and the markets when you get a depression, a recession, how everyone, you know, the markets and the economy that I believe we don't need to have economic cycles. Economic cycles make sense in agricultural civilization when you have good weather and bad weather. But in a society of services, it's a psychological problem, no? That sometimes you are very euphoric, very positive, very optimist, and you get to the euphoria, and everything go up, 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 and a lot of inflation of assets and crazy things. In some way, something is happening now. And in the other way, you are pessimistic, you are depressed, and everything is bad, everything will become worse, and you get out of everything anytime, any price. And this is not, that's completely irrational. That's important to know the balance sheets, but also it's clear that some things will change. You know, a country that has a problem with prices, after a devaluation, prices are very down, very low, they need to come back to have investments. There is a overshoot of the currency and some other conditions. And we have done when we are very clear that, we are not speculators or investors short term, we are looking for a long-term plan. We don't worry about what is happening because there is a crisis today, like it was the 95 crisis. We invest more. it's a better moment to invest because you find many opportunities of people that want to get out. When Telefonica went to Mexico, when your competitor go to your country, and you are only there, anyone that is an international company and you stay only in your market, he can corner you, because he can move the prices as he like, just to destroy the market position you have. So we decide to go to that where he were. We can go to Spain. It was a pity. We should love to be in Spain, but we went to many countries that we were, like Argentina, Peru, Brazil, especially Brazil. And when we were looking that we were going to be international, we told our managers who want to be international, and the ones who want to be international, we gave a special training. Accelerated training, because they were going to be to other countries, no? And, we begin in Brazil and in a small part of Brazil and Colombia and Ecuador and Guatemala. Well, many countries. We are in 17 countries. If it is some company available in good terms, we buy the company. And in other places, we go from we buy the license, and we begin with zero, from grassroots, like you say, root grass. That was the case of Uruguay. In Brazil, there are many regions. Some regions, we buy a company there. In other regions, we buy the license. Depending of the price that you are paying. If they are selling you very, very, very expensive, and you can have the license, it's better the license. Always it's better to begin with a company working, because they have already market infrastructure. You win time if there is already in the market. There are some principles that we use that are the way we work, and that we try to live all the time and work with them. That not in order, maybe I don't will remember all of them, is that the money that go from a business get evaporated, that you will look for reinvestment, that you be very competitive with the more modern equipment that you can have and the technology, and follow the international reference, and that not to have too much the structure should be very, very thin, not to have many levels of management. When you have the president, the sub-president, the rep-president, the tal, and you are very far from the operation, then you have many, the concept is to be directly in the operation, hands-on. Regularly, when you have in an industry, we don't have corporative, because the people of the director and the president of the company works in the industry, inside the industry with the labor people, with the people there. And when are good times, capitalize strongly and accelerate the growing. And in the bad times, don't need to make layouts, because you are working with what you need. It's like in sports. Sometimes you have a team, and there is a manager or a coach or something in charge, or a technical director. And some of them make a very good team, and others make a very bad team of the same people. You need the people that love the what they are doing, to work in harmony, to work in team, to work together, and that they feel that they are working in a group that is a winner, and that they can develop there. Actually, we other of the things we take the people, we look that the executive functions are from the same people that is working in the group. Not from one company in the group of the other, we can move, but we don't bring people from outside regularly. We create the people inside. We develop the people inside. You have the privilege and responsibility of managing wealth. I know, and my children are educated in the same area, that when I die, I will not take anything. I think that the wealth, that people that has wealth of his own, or maybe a government, a politician that manage the wealth of the people or the responsibility to manage money, the responsibility is to be efficient with the wealth, to manage it okay. And you are worried about the efficiency and the way you use it. At the end, you manage the wealth temporary when you are alive. And maybe you're still alive, you put the wealth to be managed by others. Look, when you are worried about the organization. Actually, you are taking care of the interest of the investors. You are worried if there is something bad in the price or the value of the company because you are doing wrong things. But if you are doing right things and the markets move up and down, you worry to do about things, not to worry to make things happen in the short term, but in the long term, no. And when you are doing the right things, the value will be there, will come. I think it's a social responsibility to make wealth, produce more wealth. For the end of the day, it will go to the society. And also give you the possibility to use this wealth for other purposes beyond the business. That means that that's my belief, that it's crazy that you make wealth, you have a wealth, and you leave it to a foundation when you died, looking for others to do you don't know what. I think that all this should be done in life. During the life, you should use your wealth outside the business to other causes, to other risks, to other jobs like nutrition. That's what we do in our foundations. Nutrition, health, child health, education. That is the main reason of the new civilization. You need to have good education and justice and other programs of high impact. We try to do it in high impact. Actually, I am going to begin a new company, and I think we are just beginning to develop outside Mexico to get international. And also, we have a new concept and company to put it to work in the near term. First, you begin creating an organization with a team of salesmen, not with one. You need to create many hundreds of salesmen to go to the market to offer the product. And what you can do maybe if you are going to begin is to find in which area the casualties are lower, the risks are lower because there are less stolen cars and accidents. You can begin in this place. And well, you will begin selling one maybe at 11 o'clock, but at 5 o'clock maybe you have sell 100 and 200 next day and 600 and 1,000. And as much as you go there, you are taking a statistical risk. An insurance company is regulated, so our business is regulated and you need to have the license. If you don't have the capital, minimum capital, and you don't have it, they will not give you a license. maybe he can begin selling insurance if he loved the business, like a seller, like a salesman, insurance salesman, no? That's what he can do. But I don't know, if he loved the business, he can begin selling insurance, then to invite people to work with him, to make a team of salesmen, and grow in this way. And if he has a big portfolio of business, and he's looking to go for another risk and go for a sales, a insurance company, maybe he can look a partnership or move for a license. Or, but he need to capitalize first and work on other areas, because if not, he will not have the license for insurance company. You will not buy insurance in a company without capital. In U.S. it is beautiful, and in other countries, because you have venture capital. When you have a good project and a good proposition, you can find the support of investors. In other areas, you need to find capital from, I don't know, friends or some kind of funds that can push the capitalization of business. But I think that the people that don't have any capital can begin working or associating, be an associate of one that has the capital, no? Then you know there is the joke that the one who has the capital and the other have the experience, and they lose everything, and now the one of the capital has the experience. When you love life, you know, you want to know more about life, no? I think engineering is important, give you the tools. And in business, to analyze, it's important to simplify it, to have the essential points, the essential issues, the fundamental, the basics, and take out everything that is secondary, to have less variables to study or to look at. Because when you have a lot of variables and you don't make a distinction between the ones that are essential and the secondary ones and parameters, you have confusion. I will say that engineering is important, but also when I was finishing my career, I make my thesis about linear programming, and that's operation research, that is to optimize functions, optimize results of things, and a study of models that take you to the optimization of the solutions. When I was studying that many years ago, 45 years ago, the parametric linear programming was very interesting, because the problem in the models are the parameters. That is very difficult to define precisely. And the parametric give you at which number the solution is optimal. And in some way, one teacher say that one engineer is someone who makes with $1 what others that are not engineers make with $2. When you make the evaluation of things, when you look this kind of investments, it's very important, and I think maybe it's more important than engineering, to understand the economy, the macroeconomy. The macroeconomy is very important, to know the national accounts, what means fiscal deficit, what means trade deficit or trade superavit, what means each item, but not only quantitative, but also qualitative. I think economy is very important to know the basics of economy, to understand what is happening. No, you need to understand economy, you need to understand the financial statements of the companies, the sectors, and to have world references. I don't know. I think that more than instinct, there are circumstances, and experience. I think is important to know a little the whole, like you say, integrated items. But well, I think that from the first moment in 65 that I begin founding the companies, I always believe that I am not an executive. I am more an entrepreneur, and I am not a people that work from 8 to 6 or from 9 to 5, and I don't have the characters of the executives, no? I think in business, you have the executives, the CEOs, the executives, the investors, and the entrepreneur. They are different. The entrepreneur is more a creator, promoter, and he work with executives. The executives are the ones who have the work to be done, the organization, a leadership in the organization, but the entrepreneur need to be the leadership of the leaderships. I think the small and middle business, the same one is the three things. The same person is the owner, is the investor, and is the executive. There are not fight the possibility to have the three positions. And you cannot make a separation in the middle and small business, because the entrepreneur and the businessman, like you want to call him, has the three characteristics. Now, he's the owner of the business, he's the investor in the business. Sometimes they find partners that invest with them. The investor is one that have confidence in the management and in the economic sector and make an investment there in private companies or in public companies. And mostly you think an investor that is thinking in medium plus or maybe medium term or maybe long term. He's not selling and buying every day, no? The one who sell and buy all the days is like a gambler, no? He looks the adrenaline. It's like a kind of Rambo, economic Rambo, no? Business Rambo, financial Rambo, no? They don't want, they want to feel the adrenaline, no other things. Well, I begin to invest when I was not a teenager, before being maybe 10 or 12 years old, like an investor. Thus, I have this experience like investor. I learned on those times what is, how you call interest compuesto, when you capitalize interest, compound interest. And I learned many things when I was very young, maybe 12 or 13 years. Then I understand how to learn a balance sheet. I don't learn that in the school. And when you look at a balance sheet, there are a lot of information, not only a balance sheet, but also a estado resultados. That's a report, financial statements in general, no? I think finances, to invest, there are some principles that are very clear, but very easy. You invest with basic conditions. You invest when you have confidence in the management, in the sector, you like the sector, and the value of the prices are not high, or let's say are low value. No, you are buying intrinsic values in good companies and in good markets and in good sectors. No, I think these kind of things are basics and are not complicated. The training I have for one thing and the other to study financial statements during many years, maybe 10 years or 15 years, and my experience in many areas, and the facility maybe to simplify the variables. Take out parameters that are not necessary or variables that are secondary, and look the essential issues of the business. I really think that I make things that are not very rational, like get involved in so many, too many areas, too many sectors, doing so many things, so different things. And the reason was that when you have not more area to grow in one business, you diversify. Because I have done really maybe 50 or 60 different things. I don't know how many, a lot. That don't make too much sense. It's not a recommendation to others to do that. We have done paper, candies, tires. We compete with the international companies, soft drinks, construction, bicycles, mining, telecommunications, metals, financial services, insurance, and oil platforms and infrastructure and road tolls, etc., etc. I think bakery, retail, that's, I think, dangerous. We have been relatively successful. We have get out of some of these areas. But I think it's important to focus in the areas where the sectors that you look with a good potential, that are part of the dynamic sectors that will grow strongly, where you can do things, and follow world references. And we have competed with many companies. Actually, in paper, we compete with Kimberly-Clark and Scott Paper without a foreign partner. In tires, we compete with Bridgestone, with Michelin, with Goodyear without a foreign partner, and we were the leaders in the market. In tobacco, we compete with British American Tobacco. We have a foreign partner. I think that it's important not only to separate your activities like investor and like a entrepreneur, but also to have more focus and more focus. There is a moment where you cannot. It's not recommendable. It's not good for others to get involved in so much areas. We have get out of many of these fields. We have sold out many of these sectors because they were too much. I think every time I understand better the civilization we are living. I am understanding better the future. I have a more clear vision of the future and a more clear vision of the present. For me, that changed many things in life, no? And one of them is what I was asking you about I was telling you about the new company. This new company that we are trying to put in work soon will make efforts to push the development of Latin America. Because there are many projects, there are a lot of money, and you need to put them together. That's what we will do. And as you grow older, you have other challenges. And this is one of the biggest challenges. I feel that I am just beginning my big challenges now. The challenges of the other challenges are in the past, but my big challenge is coming just today, in this age, and to try to do this kind of things that can change in some way, not change, accelerate the development of our country. And as much as I look not only the business environment, but also what is happening in the world and how the economy is managed and what things they are doing,
I am more convinced that many things should be adjusted and that the government should have more clear what is what is the new civilization, what it means, which are the new paradigms, what things will happen, and the terrible risk that we have that this transformation, during this transition, there will be a lot of problems because people has fear for change, fear for something that didn't understand, and if we don't manage it very well, it will be very costly socially, economically, and to many people will be terrible. And that's a big challenge, and that's a big point. And that's something that I don't know 10 years ago. Let's say that way of thinking and learning and reading is the last 6-8 years that I am looking at very clear. And every day I look at more clear. And talking with people that was first in these ideas, like Alvin Toffler, is very important, and other people that has studied that in a very in theoretical and pioneer way.
I believe that family and personal life and business or professional life is not only compatible, it's necessary. You will have a better professional life with a good personal life and family life that if you don't have a good personal life and a family life. I think I don't understand the contrary. And it's very clear that the good personal life make you stronger. You are stronger for the challenges. You are working. I think I don't believe in working 20 hours or 16 hours or 14 hours. When you work too much, it's because your job is beyond you. You are not controlling you are not doing good your job. If you need to be 15 hours, 16 hours, it's because you are not organized. You don't have delegation of your responsibility. I don't believe that in any business, in any activity, you need to work 15 or 16 hours and you don't have time for yourself or for your family or for anyone. There are invited many important businessmen from Latin America with his children and with his family. And we are like 200 that get together, and we have it's clear that you live socially also, but we make presentation about different issues, and global companies, familiar companies, social problems, etc. It has been very successful. We are very happy with that, and I think one of the main reasons to say that is that we have 7 meetings. In this new meeting, will be in Central America. The first was in Mexico. We organized that and we invite there. The second in Dominican, then Brazil, Buenos Aires, Santiago, and Panama. We have some propositions now in Panama. We have talked a lot about that and work already in some of these areas. We are thinking to make a confederation of foundations, of Latin American foundations, to get together for some programs, some projects, to have information what one do and the other, to try to work more together the foundations. That's one interesting point. And I think we will create maybe also a fund between the businessman of Latin America for Central America to invest in infrastructure, physical infrastructure. We learn from each other. But it's interesting because in some areas, the fathers talk and the other, the children talks. Because they are 30, 35, 40, many are on charge of the business. And we learn of each other. doesn't matter the generation, and it's clear the energy of the youngs, the energy of the young people, also of the old people, though, and the compromise, and that they are very clear of the social responsibility of the business community. I think when I was 19 or 20 years, I had the opportunity to be professor in the university, in the National University, in the school where I was studying when I was in third or fourth grade. And it was a very important experience, and I enjoyed it a lot. The class was algebra. It was not it's nothing that you can make more than academic, because I believe in academic and information, formation of the students and the people, no? And I think that for the education of your children, it's very important the experience you can have, and you can remember what you feel, how you think when you were a child about the things that are you talking with them. And I believe that this is important. It's very important, a good relation with them, especially if they are going to follow you, what you are doing. In my case, my children like the entrepreneur activity and the business activity, because from when they were a child, they were compatible with the family and the life, no? And I am very impressed that they manage very well his personal life, his family, their family life, and his business activity. I think they are a good example. They are a good example. And I believe that sometimes, more than educate our children, we make something like domestication. Don't do that, make that, go there, put there, take out that. But, you know, like if we're training without rationality, without without any common sense or rationality of the things you talk with them, without formation. I think it's important to leave your children a better country, but it's maybe more important to leave your country better children, first of all. And second, you are looking for the happiness of your children, and they need to, and I think that work is not only a social responsibility, but it's a emotional need. You need to work, you need to do things, you know, you need to be active. You cannot be lazy without doing anything. It's bad for your emotional health, no? And what I tried to educate, and that was education of my father's also, with responsibility and compromise. Because at the end, wealth is responsibility and compromise. And you, when you die, you don't take anything. You are a kind of temporary manager of wealth. My challenge for the next 7 years, first 3 years and then seven, the first step 3 years and the second step seven, a challenge is to create human and physical capital in our countries, in Latin America. And that's now my challenge. That's what I am more involved and interested. And what's that? Health, nutrition, health, education, and jobs. And physical infrastructure. That means airports, ports, roads, highways, power plants, energy, telecommunications, etc. And housing. And that's what I am trying to do for the last years. I left my boards outside Mexico and in Mexico, and I am concentrating in this challenge to look how our country has more human capital and physical capital, trying to help that and to support that by looking it like through the foundations that I create and through the investment. I believe that poverty is not fight with donation or charity. You cannot fight poverty with debt relief, donations, social programs. You fight poverty only with good education and good and jobs. Jobs is the way to fight poverty. And in the past, the problem of poverty was a problem, a ethical problem, a moral problem, a problem of social justice. Today, in this new civilization, to fight poverty is an economic need. If you don't fight poverty, the country don't develop. In the past, you have slaves. You fight for earth, for soil, and people to work for nothing. Now you don't need the physical labor. You need mental knowledge, labor that know what to training skills, labor. And that's why you need the education and the human capital. And that's what I am convinced, and that's what I am working, and that's what now I am more interested, no? No, it's a process. Always. It's very clear for a long time. The foundation has 20-something years, Foundation Carso. It's a very old foundation, and that's the way we formally begin to do that. No, what is clear, maybe every time more, I believe that the skills, the training of the entrepreneur are very good to solve social problems. The problems, social and economic problems. Because not because you have resources, economical resources that are important, or material resources, because you look how to manage these resources, you understand how to have leadership to solve problems. In business, you constantly have problems and problems and problems, and you have a great training for that. And when you look at some of the things that are happening in our countries, in all the countries, but currently in our countries, you say, well, that can be done like this way and this way and this way. And if you have the human resources, material resources, the team, and the skills and the experience, I think it's a very important and great thing to do. The government is clear that it's not enough. There are not enough resources to do that. And they are getting more popular, what in England was done many years ago, the PPPs, public-private partnerships, that associates private investment. The governments, all the governments, including the most radicals maybe, believe in private investment in some way. Well, you need the combination of private investment and public investment, because public investment is not enough to solve the problems. And the innovation that you can bring, like a people with experience in business, is very important to solve these kind of problems. There is other point that I think is very clear. Governments, as much as they can have labor, they don't give more than 10% of the labor. Actually, the population economical active is like 40% of the population. Let's say in U.S. should be 120 million, no? 40% of 300. And there are not more than 10%, around 10%. The government will not solve only a small part of the employment. Private investment, big business, and are not solving the problem. You need to develop a small business, take down the business mortality, like we get down the child mortality. You need to take down the business mortality and promote small and medium business, that there are a lot of jobs there, and promote health, and promote entertainment, and promote education, that you will have a lot of employment there, and finance them, because the problem is over-regulation and financing. And we are beginning to create some concepts for financing a small business. Let's say in Telmex, we are going to finance our customers just because they pay regularly. We are going to finance them at 2 years or 3 years without so many papers and information and documents. More expedito, easier, more quicker and carefully.
I think vocation, motivation, what you study, what you read, what you learn, and especially to organize a team of people, human resources, no? A team of people that get motivated, that work with you, that accept your leadership, and that you are constantly forming, educating, and work with a motivation that make them feel that they can achieve anything that they propose, and to feel to be part of a winner team, a team that is triumphant, that can win, that is winning. That motivated more the people. And that's the way you look in sports, it's the same in politics, it's the same in science. Why this team do that, or why Barry Bonds is breaking this record, and why Pelé make these things, or Maradona, or because they are good with this vocation, they have talents, but also they work strongly. They work not in number of hours, but in training and learning and planning and creating. If you were an investor, you can do it by yourself. And that's also that sometimes there is a confusion. An investor, a speculator, can do it by himself. Well, nearly by himself. He needs information and something to, and operators and everything. But he can do it without any people, with a small office. But if you are operating business, if you are operating companies, if you are operating industries or any business, you need a team to work on that and to make it happen well. You know? And to look always to make it better. And as much as you have a good team, you can do that. Well, what we used to do is to have young people in the companies, and that they go as far as they can and as they want. And that means that many of the people that, most of the people that is in charge of the areas came from inside of the companies, no? And there are the training that they have inside, they learn how we think, how we operate, how we work, they like it. Many times, to some of them, they have offers of higher revenues, incomes, and they stay with us. They stay in the team, thinking in the long term and not thinking in the short term. I think that people have different vocations. Let's say my three children work in the business. But I told them, if you don't like the business, don't get involved, because you finish with your life and you finish with the business. And sometimes you need to be far of that, because you have other vocation of other interests. I think that each of these boys that are outstanding, they are privileged in some way because of his own reasons, because of his studies and his efforts. They need to find which area they want to be in, and in this area to look how to be every time better, but especially to be inside better, to know him very good, and to try to have a good family, a good to be happy, because that will make him stronger for the things he will do. And well, the first thing to recommend is that they don't work in some place that they don't like. that they don't do things that they don't like, that they look what they are really want to do and what kind of team they want to be involved, of the, if they want to go alone by themselves, and to find that. And after they find that, to get involved in a team and work like in a team, no? I try not to think on that, no? I will be, what I am worried not is how I will be remembered. What I worry is about the future of my family, my sons, my grandchildren, that they get together, that they love each other, that they can be positive for themselves and for the society. And that's my worry. I don't worry to be remembering one way or the other. I will be remembered very well by my children and my friends. You know, what I told you about the new civilization is really very important. It's really very important because things can move and will move faster than what we are waiting or we are thinking. And we can push them to be faster and a ordinary evolution. And not with crashes and problems and social turmoil or problems like this, no? When the civilization begin, when the agriculture was discovered, is because the glaciation was finished and there were a lot of paradises, where a lot of water, a lot of animals, fauna and flora in excess, and people that was nomads get sedentary there. And as they get sedentary, they begin to think, but they don't worry that 30 has not job or 40 has not job. That was not unemployment. They were not troubles in the change. They begin to go up very soon to look the sun, to look for housing and look for clothes and to look for organizing other things, etc. But now that technology is creating so fast, so well, so much wealth, we don't know how to manage that. And we have unemployment, we have poverty, worst. And it's a problem of management, of organize the production of wealth that is like never before, so efficient, so fast, so many goods, so many services, so low cost for do everything. But creating wealth, you have the paradox of higher poverty. That's stupid. That's very stupid. In the past, in the agricultural civilization, 200 years ago and more, all the power was in the hands of the monarchy, the pharaoh, the Tlatoani, the emperor, no? And as much as it advanced, the power is in the society. Not only the private sector that has more thing to do, but all the society, the non-government organizations is every time taking more, the academics, the newspapers, the media is taking more of the area. What should be done is more faster and organized. And the private sector is more efficient, a businessman and a executive, a private executive, than a public executive and a politics, by definition. And all this should be changed sooner. But like you say, turmoil is getting worse in many places because the fear of change, the fundamentalism, the change of the paradigms, they are not clear that paradigms are different. They put the globalization like the cause of the problems. Globalization is only one of the consequences of technology. Globalization is part of the communications. You move from the speed of the horse and the engine of steam engine to the speed of the light and the sound light. But technology is the what is doing the difference. Unemployment don't come from globalization, come from technology. But technology create a lot of wealth and a lot of productivity. What you need is to find how you move to other people's
to be involved in the economy and in life and employment. I think who is doing it very good is China. China is getting in the new civilization in the way and the timing they like. Doing very fast, but thinking very long term. There is a Chinese proverb that say, bad governments worry about rich. Good governments worry about poor. What they are doing is to move from a rural and agricultural society to an industrial society and to a new civilization society. But they cannot do it from night to day, day to night. They are doing it with a long-term planning, very fast, but it will be things of maybe two generations, but they are doing the right thing to do. Before all, everyone was poor. Actually, the idea of developing human capital and physical capital needs from some areas that are not profitable, you need to have the foundations. But where it is profitable and it's important that physical infrastructure is profitable, will be investment. I think the combination of both is very important. Are both fundamental to the development of our countries, to fight poverty, and to break the barrier of underdeveloped. I think that you need to arrive to some kind of income per capita, some level of income per capita that is like a speed to break the barrier of underdevelopment, no? Like to get out of the earth, you need some speed to break the gravitational forces. You need revenue per capita to break it. And I think many of our countries are near that. And I think investment is very important because employment is given by investment. So you need to invest, and business need to invest, and business are necessary to break to give employment. And by the other side, what is not profitable or short-term profitable should be supported by foundations, like is the human capital, the health of the people, nutrition, to work, and then they work together, I think. It's human capital. We are working, what you say, culture and arts is where we are more advanced, but also environment. You need to take care of the environment, medio ambiente, we say, environment, ecology and medio ambiente, environment, arts, and entertainment, sports also. We are also working in sports. And that's human capital, no? Human and social capital. To have this kind of support of the activities by the private sector.